Shalom. I want to give all the praise, all the glory, all the honor unto Yahawah, Ba'ashem, Yahweh Shai, Ba'ashem, Rukah Kudash. Double honors goes out to the elder apostles of Great Millstone for teaching me the truth. Also, I want to acknowledge all the Akyam who are pushing the truth with sincerity throughout the four corners of the earth. All right. So, just going into, just a little, this history in 1 Samuel 18. And just the story on David, they're talking about this whole little chapter is basically going in on Saul and David and how, Saul was basically a hater on David, right? King David. So let's go ahead and read it from the top. It says, "And it came to pass, when he had made an end of speaking unto Saul, that the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul." So, these Christians are bugged out. They try to go into this verse here and try to make it sound like David and Jonathan were homosexuals. But, David it was a righteous man. So in the eyes of Yahawah, right, he was a man after Yahawah's heart, meaning a man after Yahawah's mind. He was like-minded with Yahawah, so there's no way that he would have been a homosexual. But, I just wanted to point that out because these damn Christians, a lot of these pastors will try and go into and, make it sound like this was some gay thing, But there was none of that going on. Verse 2, "And Saul took him that day and would let him go no more home to his father's house." Talking about Jonathan. "Then Jonathan stripped himself of the robe that was upon him and gave it to David and his garments, even to his sword and to his bow and to his girdle." Because that's that term, you take your shirt off, take the shirt off my back, I mean, you'll do just about anything for somebody that you have a high esteem, or somebody that you love, or somebody that you care about, That's all that was about. It wasn't about no gay shit, That's what these Christians pastors try to make it be, but that's not the case again. So let me keep reading this. It says in verse 5, "And David went out whithersoever Saul sent him, and behaved himself wisely. And Saul set him over the men of war, and he was accepted in the sight of all people, and also in the sight of Saul's servants." So everybody loved David, man. King David was a beloved. This was before he was king, right? Because Saul is still king. Verse 6, "And it came to pass as they came, when David was returned from the slaughter of the Philistine, that the women came out of all the cities of Israel singing and dancing to meet King Saul with tabrets, with joy, and with instruments of music." And this is really what made this is really one of the reasons why Saul was hating on David. It was because the women, man, the women of Israel, they were speaking more highly of David than they were of the king. That's how beloved King David was, right? So verse 7 says, "And the women answered one another as they played and said, Saul hath slain his thousands and David his 10,000s. See, so this right here, this little phrase right here, this pissed off Saul. He was jealous. He was like, oh, these bitches are talking about I slain 1,000 and David slaying 10,000. So he was all up in his... just being a hater on King David, which, again, he wasn't the king yet. But verse 8, "And Saul was very wroth, and the saying displeased him, and said, They have ascribed unto David 10,000s, and to me they have ascribed but thousands. And what can he have more but the kingdom?" So he was threatened by King, by David. He was threatened. He didn't like it. David made him look bad in his eyes. verse 9. And saw I David from that day and forward. So he had his eye on King David, right? Okay, verse 10. And it came to pass on the morrow that the evil spirit from the Most High came upon Saul. And he prophesied in the midst of the house. And David played with his hand as all the other. Oh, so lucky. Let me change this song. Let's go back. So lucky, yeah. All right, let's get this. All right, it says verse 10. And it came to pass on the morrow that the evil spirit from the Most High came upon Saul, and he prophesied in the midst of the house. And David played with his hand as at other times, and there was a javelin in Saul's hand. All right, so that evil spirit, this proves to you that, hey, these spirits, Yahawah puts these spirits on people, you see? Well, Yahawah is the one who puts spirits on people, man. Whether it's a good spirit, a righteous spirit, evil spirit. In this case, it was an evil spirit that the Most High put on Saul. All right? So, you know, when people are doing fucked up shit, hey, guess what? Just know that Yahawah put the spirit on them. Even your wife. If your wife is acting up, being a, you know, being a nag, being a nuisance, she's just nagging you constantly, talking shit to you. Hey, Yahawah's the one who put that spirit on her. You gotta consider. You gotta remember. You know? Verse 11. And Saul cast the javelin, for he said, I will smite David even to the wall with it. So, and David, Salakia, I lost my spot. And David avoided out of his presence twice. So basically Saul had this wicked ass spirit on him. He's throwing these javelins, like a spear, at David. And David dodged it twice. Right? He busted out Barry Sanders. He dodged those javelins that hating ass Saul threw at him. Okay, verse 12. And Saul was afraid of David because Yahawah was with him and was departed from Saul. All right, and that's how it is. A lot of these people can see that Yahawah is with us, you know. They might not agree that or believe our doctrine or our words, but deep down, you know, their spirit is like knows that Yahawah is dealing with us, and sometimes, you know, it's like I don't know how they feel exactly, but these people, you know, especially these wicked elite, they know. They know that Yahawah is dealing with. So people can tell when Yahawah is dealing with you, especially in this, when he's dealing with you, you know, certain people can understand and tell that he's dealing with us. Let's see where did I leave off. Verse 13, therefore Saul removed him from him and made him his captain over 1,000. And he went out and came in before the people. And David behaved himself wisely in all his ways. And Yahawah was with him. All right, so David was always, you know, circumspect, wise in his behavior. And us as the elect, the hopeful elect, you know, we gotta, you know, move with wisdom. You know, even dealing with our women, you don't even really want to share the truth with the women because, you know, after time, it can be a vexation of spirit if you teach your woman too much about this truth. Because really, these women, they're not ready for, you know, the truth. They're not set up to receive the entire truth right now. especially here in Babylon. You know, these, whether your woman is in that Babylonian spirit or not, you know, if she's trying to be righteous, then that's beautiful. That's your pa. But if she's not, you know, that she's not going to, you know, she's not going to be able to receive the entire doctrine. So, you know, if they have questions, it's okay to ask. The scripture says, and they should learn from their husbands at home. But really, you don't want to just go out of your way to teach your woman the knowledge and the truth, the wisdom. So where am I at? Verse 15. It says, wherefore, when Saul saw that he behaved himself very wisely, he was afraid of him. So you see, the better we do, when we're moving wise and people can see how we move, this becomes like a fearful thing on them. They're like, oh shit, this motherfucker doesn't fuck up. This mother, you know, there's a verse speaking on you don't want to bring any, I'm paraphrasing, but it's basically saying you don't want to bring any shame to the ministry, you see. So let me see if I can get that verse real quick. And really, when I'm saying this stuff, it goes for me first, you know. So I'm speaking to myself when I say that stuff, you know. Everything we do when we teach, you know, it also applies to us, you know. Saying it wrong. Let's see. Okay, there, we'll use that one. 2 Corinthians 6:3 it says, giving no offense in anything, that the ministry be not blamed. You see, so this is what it is. It's better. It's wise for us to move wisely, like King David's here. He, you know, giving no offense in anything, that the ministry be not blamed. All right. So that's how we want to move. We don't want somebody to be able to like those idiots. I forgot which group it was. The ones that were. The ones were that were bringing weapons to camp and stuff like that, and also bringing guns to camp. That group, I forgot what group it was. You don't want to be doing stuff like that, because then you're bringing a dark cloud over the ministry, because then other you know, they're already going to demonize us, you know. So you don't want to give them ammo, especially dudes like Vocab Malone. You know, like when IUIC and ISUBK, I think, I forget who it was, they were fighting on the street and making the Hebrew Israelites look bad, you know, because they were fighting over a street corner and some Christian pastor was recording it across the street. And it was like gold in the hands of Vocab Malone. Because he, you know, he uses anything that he can to try to exploit, the Hebrew Israelites, to demonize the truth, which, you know, he can only go so far, because Yahawah Shem Yoshai at the end of the day is in control. But every time he speaks on the Hebrew Israelites, he brings attention to the Hebrew Israelites. So really, you know, but you don't want to be, you know, like it says here, giving no offense in anything, that the ministry be not blamed. See. All right, let me get back to that. That's just the spirit, you know. Let me go back to the 1 Samuel 18 and 16. It says, but all Israel and Judah loved David, because he went out and came in before them. All right, so he was a man of the people. People loved the tribes loved David. Verse 17. And Saul said to David, "Behold, my elder daughter Merab, her will I give thee to wife, only be thou valiant for me." And fight Yahweh's battles. For Saul said, "Let not mine hand be upon him, but let the hand of the Philistines be upon him." Right, so he was, his plot was to give King David, or again, I keep calling him King David, but he wasn't king yet. So he was trying to give David Merab, which was his daughter, but she was to be as a trap, as a snare. That was his plot, and he wanted to, you know, him to do the. He says, "I want you to fight Yahweh's battles." And he wanted the Philistines to kill him. You know? Verse 18. 1 Samuel 18 and 18, it says, "And David said unto Saul, Who am I, and what is my life, or my father's family in Israel, that I should be son-in-law to the king?" So King David, man, he was rubbing Saul wrong in every single aspect, in every single way. Because he was just like moving so wise and perfect, right? Saul was just like, "God damn, this motherfucker doesn't fuck up, you know? He's humble, right? He's like, you know, right here, he's like, who am I, you know, that I should be the son-in-law of the king, you know?" Verse 19, "But it came to pass at the time when Merab, Saul's daughter, should have been given to David, that she was given to Adriel the Meholathite to wife. And Michal, Saul's daughter, loved David, and they told Saul, and the thing displeased." No, I'm sorry. "And the thing pleased him." So Saul was a bastard, man. He was a dickhead. He's like, you know, "I'm gonna give Merab," and then all of a sudden he gives him to this dude named Adriel, which that's fucked up, you know. You say, "Oh, I'm gonna give you my daughter," you end up. So he was a total dick, you know. He ended up giving Merab to the other dude. But guess what? Saul's other daughter, Michal, she had a thing for David, man. Remember that song, "I got a thing for you"? Anyway, let's keep reading. Verse 21. "And Saul said, I will give him her, that she may be a snare to him, and that the hand of the Philistines may be against him. Wherefore Saul said to David, Thou shalt this day be my son-in-law, and the one of the twain." So, you know, Michal, she was down to be David's wife. And if you remember later on, she was hating on David also, like her father. When he got the Ark of the Covenant, was dancing, and his clothes fell off. He was dancing so hard. You know, if you remember that story. And his daughter, Saul's daughter Michal, she was hating on King David, man, when he was celebrating getting the Ark of the Covenant back to Israel. But anyway, that's a whole nother story. But, you know, she had a little of her daddy in her because she was a hater too. Jealous of King David. Jealous of David. All right, verse. Yeah, even your woman could be jealous of you, man. And I've had that. You get a woman, man, and she, I don't know what the fuck spirit that is. That's an evil woman, really, a wicked woman. When she's jealous of you. When some of these bitches, they want to be in competition with you when you're with them. Which to me, I think that's just absolutely stupid. And it's like, what the fuck's wrong with you? You know? They'll never admit it, but you could see it in their actions. And like I say, it don't even make no damn sense, but so, these women are so bugged out, man. These women are bugged out. All right, let's see here. Verse 20. Let's see. Verse 22. "And Saul commanded his servants, saying, Commune with David secretly, and say, Behold, the king hath delight in thee, and all his servants love thee. Now therefore be the king's son-in-law." See, he was always just being a snake, man. he almost had like a spirit of Esau on him. And these, you know, these two thirds, that's how they are. They're just like Esau, you know. Verse 23. And Saul's servant spake those words in the ears of David, and David said, "Seemeth it to you a light thing to be the king's son-in-law, seeing that I am a poor man and lightly esteemed?" See, again, always humble. He's like, "Man, you, who am I? What, like, you think it's to take this thing lightly that I'm going to be the king's son-in-law? Come on, man." You know what I mean? That was his attitude. He's like, "Come on, man. What do you, you make it sound like it's no big deal." Let's keep reading. Verse 24. And the servants of Saul told him, saying, "On this manner spake David." And Saul said, "Thus shall ye say to David, the king desireth not any dowry." Dowry is like payment, right? I think it must be the parent, that the father of the son pays the dowry for a daughter, if I'm remembering right. It's like a payment, you know, it's like, but anyway, let me keep reading. But in, it says, "The king desireth not any dowry, but in," because he told him he was poor, right? "But 100 foreskins of the Philistines to be avenged of the king's enemies. But Saul thought to make David fall by the hand of the Philistines." So he was like, "Look, he don't want no dowry. He just wants you to bring 100 foreskins from these Philistines. You know, go to battle, kill them. You bring 100 foreskins and you're in good with the king," basically, you see. And let's keep reading. Verse 26. And when his servants told David these words, it pleased David well to be the king's son-in-law, and the days were not expired. Wherefore David arose and went, and he and his men, and slew the Philistines 200 men. And David brought their foreskins, and they gave him, and they gave them in full tale to the king, that he might be the king's son-in-law. And Saul gave him Michal, his daughter, to wife. So he asked for 100 Philistines foreskins, and King David, the Lord was with him. You got to remember that. So what happened? He came back with 200 foreskins, doubled it. So this really, made Saul pissed off, right? Down on the down low, he couldn't even show it that he was mad. You know, he was too busy. The Lord put that spirit of hate, being a hater, on him. And that's the other thing. The Lord puts the spirits on these people, everybody. He controls all the spirits, man. So even when you got a hater, it's Yahawah that put that person to be that hater on you. Or somebody just, you know what I mean? Whatever it is, they're a nuisance to your spirit. Well, guess who caused that to happen? Everything's of Yahawah, man. Yeah, this is just like a test, man. You know? We're constantly being tested and tried in the fire. Verse 28. But you know, when you know this, and you, it's kind of, you know, you can accept it better. You can control your own spirit better. You see? But if you don't know, you're just a loose cannon, and you don't know why things are the way they are, then that's the advantage that we have in this truth, in this knowledge, in this wisdom. Right? Verse 28. And Saul saw and knew that Yahawah was with David, and that Michal, Saul's daughter, loved him. So Saul knew his daughter was all in love. She was, you know, whooped on King David. Verse 29. And again, he wasn't king yet. Verse 29. And Saul was yet more afraid of David, and Saul became David's enemy continually. So on the down low, he was like just hating on David, man. He didn't even like him. It was his enemy. You know? And you know what, though? The enemies of the heathen, that's a whole nother level. All right? So, let's read 30. Then the princes of the Philistines went forth, and it came to pass after they went forth that David behaved himself more wisely than all the servants of Saul, so that his name was much set by. So David was the man. You know, he was He was beloved by the men, the women, you know. People were hating. We know when everything is, you know, when people are, you're in that state where you, everything is just going real good and people, you start to feel the hate. I remember having that more, you know, more in my younger days, you know, and I'm still, I don't consider myself old, but when I was a young man, I remember having, you know, that situation. And, you know, people will hate on you, man. And you, you know, being the hopeful elect, we got to know how to control our spirits like King David, you know. Today, if the Lord's with us, man, who can be against us, as it is written, you know. But I'm going to go ahead and close out on that. I just wanted to go in, you know, on a lesson. I was reading that chapter and figured I would, you know, base the lesson on that today. So I hope the lesson was edifying. I want to give all the praise, all the glory, all the honor unto Yahawah, Ba'ashem, Yahushai, Ba'ashem, Rekha Kudash. Double honors goes out to the other apostles of Great Millstone for teaching me the truth. Also, when acknowledge all the Akyam, who are pushing the truth with sincerity throughout the four corners of the earth. Shalom to the elect. Shalom.